Hi, so we are back. This is the second part of the Human Resource Management 6th module, which is on performance management. And today we are going to do a very interesting topic, which is on performance appraisal, which means as to how an organization shall help to assess the performance of its employees and what is the reason for why an organization needs to appraise their performance of the employees. There are several advantages. One, when you get positive feedback, when you know that you're on track, when you're doing well at whatever it is that you're doing, you're going to feel more motivated. The second is it satisfies a sense of competition and helps you to continue to work towards growth and higher achievement. The next is that it helps you to understand where each employee stands. Where are the gaps in their performance? What needs to be improved? Where they need to work? What areas they need to work on? What are their strengths which the organization must use to the maximum, and so on and so forth? And then, of course, it sort of helps us create a database for all the employees, gives us all the statistical information that we would require. And bottom line is that helps you in developing the best possible optimal performance of each employee, because we have been able to assess how they are performing at the task that has been assigned to them. Let's take a quick definition of performance appraisal. It is the step where management will find out how effective it has been at hiring and placing their employees. Therefore, it is a process of evaluating the performance of an employee in terms of the requirements of a particular job. The benefits of performance appraisal are several. It will help to improve the behavior of the employee in terms of the performance at the workplace. It will help the employee's efforts to be aligned to the strategic vision of the organization. It will help the compensation and wages aspect to be taken care of as to who has to be given greater rewards for performing at higher levels and so on. It will also help in internal movement in terms of promotions and transfers and so on. And it will definitely inspire employees to work at a greater level. Let's see how we've reached the step of performance appraisal. The first element is, of course, job analysis. You describe what are the various elements of what a job requires to be done. What are the standards of performance which have been set by the organization? And then finally, you're going to do an appraisal of how our employee is performing, whether this person is performing at the expected level of work performance. If he is, then is he much higher than that? Or if he isn't, where is the gap? And how can this gap be filled up? Now let's look at various, there are many, many ways of appraising performance. You could be using some sort of scales, you could be using some checklists, you could have ranking, rating, you could have just a description of a critical incident and so on. But by and large, we divide the methods of performance appraisal into two main. The first is the traditional methods, and the second is the modern, more modern methods of performance appraisal. So let's first take up the traditional methods and discuss what they entail. The first is rating scales. Now, when I rate someone, I don't compare them to someone else. I rate them in terms of the various elements which are crucial for this job. So if there's a job which requires a greater ability to communicate with employees, for instance, the HR manager, or if there is a job which requires you to communicate well with, let's say, the customers, which is could be a sales and marketing manager, then I would rate them on communication skills on, let's say, a scale of 1 to 5. So that would be a rating scale, right? Then there are checklists. Checklists are like when I have a set of things I need to just tick off and say, okay, this person is okay on this, okay on that, and so on. And that becomes my checklist. I see out of maybe, let's say, 10 points, how many have been checked off for this particular employee. Then comes forced choice method. Forced choice method, we are going to force the rater to choose between two or three or four given alternatives, and that becomes that you have to choose between. Then comes the forced distribution method, which is again on a scale or on a distribution. We are going to ask the data to say that this person is, let's say, in the top 50 or the middle of the distribution and so on. Then comes the critical incidents. Critical incidents are key situational elements which you may have observed about the person, and the rater is going to, you know, make a list of these critical incidents, which helps them, the rater, to identify and explain that how this person is particularly behaving in at the workplace, how are the performance levels, and how the rater is able to assess the performance of this particular employee. Then you have behaviorally anchored rating scales. This is called BARS, and this is a particular type of rating scale in which we give the ratings on the basis of certain elements which are already identified. Then you have performance tests and observations. So you can give them maybe, you know, you observe their behavior while they're working, or you could ask them to do a task and then you're going to assess how they're performing at it. Then you have these confidential reports. These are very common, very popular, usually annual confidential reports. So they're called ACRs. They're very popular with the traditional method of performance appraisal. Then you have essay method, where you have the rater is going to write a little bit small, you know, essay on, so that he covers up a lot of elements of the performance of the worker. You have the cost accounting method. How much does this employee cost you in terms of wages, salaries, fringe benefits, perks, whatever? And you have to compare it to the benefits that accrue out of the performance of this employee as to how much value this person is adding to my job or my organization. Then you have the comparative evaluation, which are called ranking scales. So you rank, let's say you have 10 employees, you rank them on 1, 2, 3 as to who's performing best according to you, and so on and so forth. Then you have paired comparison, because sometimes there is a bias. So if A and B is out of A and B, I have to choose and say, I say A is better. But when I'm comparing A and C, I say, no, now this time C is better. So which, you know, this is how I'm going to create pairs of all my employees. And then I'm going to help to eliminate the bias that may have crept into my judgment. Now, all these were the traditional methods of how we are going to do performance appraisal. Now, let's come to the more modern methods of performance appraisal. So you have, first of all, the methods like management by objectives. We're going to study them one by one. We have psychological appraisals. We have assessment centers, usually larger organizations which have more number of employees would have assessment centers, which they would use not only for performance appraisal, but also for performance management and development. Then you have 360 degree feedback, and nowadays we have a new element which is called the 720 degree feedback. Let's look at each of these one by one. The first I'm going to take up is psychological assessment. There are various ways in which I can psychologically assess my employee. You could have mental manipulation. You can have little, you know, incidents, or give them little situations in which you see how they're going to perform. You can have ability tests, especially for the more technical workers. You could have work samples as to how they have performed. You could give them personality tests, and you could have introversive thinking. So you have little games kind of in which you can see whether they are thinking, you know, out of the box, are they innovative, creative, and so on. Interpersonal skills, you see how they're behaving amongst their peers, with superiors, with subordinates. Then you have the creative thinking skills, which you can test through various exercises, or the analytical skills to see whether they are able to analyze things at a certain level. Then you can have some sort of practical intelligence tests. You can have cognitive ability tests to see how mentally they're able to, grasp the situation, comprehension tests. And of course, you have supervisory rating. The next is assessment centers. Assessment centers are basically, they are like actual divisions or departments which are created in the organization, and they look at things like they ask the employees to give presentations. They could have role play exercises in which they're asked to simulate into a certain situation to see whether how they would react if that would come up. You have panel interviews, group discussions, and in-tray exercises. Out of these, I would like to discuss with you the in-tray exercises. In-tray exercises are also simulation exercises. And you could be using it for either existing employees to see how they are performing or how they would react in certain situations. But they're also used for new potential employees who you want to assess whether they'll be good for this particular job or not. So they're going to be a list of related tasks to the job, which would be like an email or a complaint or a report or whatever. And then you're going to simulate and see how these employees are going to actually behave in that. Then you have balanced scorecard. Mark mentioned a little earlier in the chart, but balanced scorecard is a very interesting new modern method of assessing the employees because it takes into account four pivotal elements of the performance. The first is financial, which is again the output input that we talked about earlier. It's going to talk about how your outputs in terms of finances, the benefits are outweighing the cost of this employee. Then you have the customers and how you're appearing to customers, how they are going to be viewing you. Internal business processes, are you able to perform according to a certain required level? And finally, learning and growth, which means that you're good at what you're doing, but are you continuing to grow and learn new things and, better yourself, reskill yourself, and improve your learning? Then you have the next, which is management by objectives. Now, I'm sure you all already know that MBO is the process by which the superior and the subordinate are going to both sit down together and they're going to set the goals or the tasks which are to be completed by the subordinate. And this is going to, sort of exist in the larger environment of the organization. The goals which are set should be such that both the employee and the employer should be confident that they're achievable and yet they are inspiring. And through this MBO exercise, the subordinate can be assessed by the superior to see whether he or she has contributed fruitfully to the MBO exercise and actually been able to achieve the goals which were objectives which were set. The next is the very interesting 360 degree feedback program, in which a 360 degree view of the employee's performance is to be assessed. So it's not just the superior, it's also the subordinates, it's also the peers, it's also the customers, it's also the, anybody else, the direct reports that are coming into the organization, which are going to be taken into consideration to ensure that the successful 360 degree feedback is available. The 720 review model is just an addition to the 360 because it talks about, doing it twice a year so that you're going to include twice the importance of how you look at the performance of the individual. So you can see in the chart as well, you see how the superiors, the subordinates, the peers, and the clients are going to be taking a 360 view. And then a 720 view is going to give you a larger narrative report, a more in-depth view of how the person is working. And so if we look at 720 degree performance appraisal, it is 360 degree appraisal twice. It provides for two rounds of feedback, a pre and a post, or a feedback approach, which is done after a certain number of months, which is going to help the individual to understand. One of the companies which is doing 720 degree feedback is Johnson's & Johnson's. They're doing an excellent job of it, and they're able to actually take a larger holistic view of how the employees perform. So that was all about for performance appraisal. We looked at all the methods of performance appraisal. We see that there are modern methods and there are the traditional methods, each of which has, I think, its own importance. And so you can't. So maybe a combination of a method, one or two of these methods would be the ideal approach. So thank you very much. And until we meet again,